Hey everyone, and welcome to the Good News and Notes with Pastor Phil. We'll be looking at scripture, its meaning, interpretation, how it affects our life, and also we're going to see how the world of music amplifies the good news. So let's buckle up and jump right in.
Welcome everybody back to the Good News and Notes with Pastor Phil. It's been a while since doing this, and it's so great to be back with you all, and I hope you've had a great summer. And we are back now into the full swing of the church after people's rally days and kickoff Sundays, and back into our schedule. And we also have here Pastor Joe, and he has come back into the reality of the church himself. So welcome, Joe. I'd like to introduce yourself.
Thank you very much. Yeah, my name is Joe Iverson. I'm at Zion Lutheran as a pastor here. Been here just over 5 years in Galesville. And so it's a great community. And just getting back from a sabbatical trek. Little trek.
Yeah, little. Yeah.
Yeah. Across the country, not just on bikes. We did have a car. Just my family did a cross-country bike tour, the Great American Rail Trail. So that starts in the very northwest corner of Washington, and it connects all those like trails that used to be railroads, but then got converted into bike trails between the northwest corner of Washington to Washington, D.C. And so that was a pretty cool adventure. It's really a highlight is just getting to see everything like through kids' eyes. Like we're pulling into Yellowstone, right? Have you been to Yellowstone, Phil?
Not myself, no.
No. Well, when you go to Yellowstone, you're going to see animals, you're going to see geysers and stuff. And my 5-year-old had can't categorize geysers in the fiction side of stories. You know, you read about these things before you go and everything's either fiction or not fiction. So she's like, you're fiction, but we're pulling into Yellowstone. And then she's like, geysers, they're for real. Everyone else is sleeping, right? Everyone's sleeping in the car. They're wake up, they're for real, geysers. And those were just the little ones. That was even before we saw, you know, Old Faithful. So seeing a couple of those pieces of magnificent spots in God's creation across the country was pretty cool.
Did you see the multicolored water and sand? And
we didn't go there because we have a 3-year-old too, and those are like docks that you walk out on. And
I've seen pictures and videos. Yeah,
yeah,
be a little dangerous.
Yeah, and they smell like rotten eggs too. Yeah.
That's what I. That's right. So you went from Washington to Washington.
Washington to Washington. Yeah, yeah.
Two completely different contexts.
Very different. And so just seeing the geography and the culture change as we did about 60 miles a day. We didn't bike all of it. Brian and Ken joked at one of our programs, because we do programs across the country, that we should actually rename the theme of our tour the Doing the Best We Can Tour. Because some days we got a lot of miles cycling in, and some days with the kids, we really didn't.
It's like a metaphor for everyday life, huh?
Yeah, it really was. I mean, parenting is parenting, right? Whether you're at home or you're on some crazy trek.
It's kind of like going into this coming week's text with Christ's authority and being obedient. And sometimes as human beings, we just do the best that we can. And thank God for grace.
Obedient. I'm not sure if kids know about that or not.
But you gave me some ideas already.
Oh, there. Great. Good, good.
So awesome. It works. So we're going to get into our text. You're going to be actually talking about what we both preached on yesterday.
Yeah.
And for me on Saturday night.
Okay.
So here we are. Matthew 20, verses 1 through 16.
All right. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for the vineyard. And after agreeing for the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them out into the vineyard. And when he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, you also go out into the vineyard, and I'll pay you whatever is right. And so they went. When he went out again about noon, and then about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And then about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, why are you standing here idle all day? They said to him, because no one has hired us. He said to him, "Well, you go out into the vineyards." And when the evening came, the landowner of the vineyards said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour of the day, and we had borne the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. The gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Perfect. So,
yeah,
there is a lot to even write maybe 10 years worth of sermons in the lectionary on this.
Yeah, yeah, you could go a lot of different directions. And I actually went a direction that I've never gone before in about 10 years of ministry.
Mm-hmm.
I preached a sermon on anger.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. I'm curious about that.
I figure it's so prevalent in our society today, and I never talk about it. And I'm like, well, I had this idea on Tuesday morning before our text study. I'm like, well, we'll see if there's anything to support that thread in the texts. And then there's the Jonah reading where he's kind of doing his thing where he's going to go preach to Nineveh about how the city is going to be destroyed. And then he goes and hangs back. He gets kind of excited to watch it be destroyed. He has a shade bush, gives him some shade. And then that bush dies and he is angry. And God's like, "Is it right? You should be angry." And Jonah's like, "Angry enough to die?" It's like, really, Jonah? Really? Yeah. You know? And so there was that. And then there was this text about the worker who was not too happy either. And then there was some wisdom in the psalm as well about how God is slow to anger and steadfast in love. So when I went over the text, I'm like, yeah, there's definitely a few threads there where I could do this.
Yeah, so, and the slate and the people who worked in the vineyard are angry. And yeah, then they make the vineyard owner angry.
Yeah, so it's not too often where I have an idea like that before I read the text. I'm like, this actually fits very well.
Oh, beautiful.
And so anyways, I got to do a little history work, right? And so we backed up to 375. There was a guy by the name of Evagrius Ponticus, Greek. Mm. No surprise there, right?
Right.
And so he was a monk, and he came up with these eight thoughts of the source of all sin. You probably have never heard of, well, you may have heard, others might have not have heard of Evagrius. But so his thoughts were, well, gluttony, greed, sloth, sorrow, lust, anger, pride, vainglory. You recognize the list.
Oh, yeah.
And so, because 2 centuries after Evagrius came up with this list, then the first pope took it and he combined two of them because he thought they were kind of the same. And he called them the seven deadly sins.
Yeah.
And then 1600 years later, a guy by the name of Brad Pitt and Morgan Freeman made a movie about it and brought that into mainstream pop culture. But I wanted to clarify, it's not the feeling that's a sin. Like Evagrius's idea was the source that they can spring from, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because there's most certainly righteous anger, and I highlighted that. There's a study that was done in the last 4 years in our society. The deaths and injuries from road rage have almost doubled.
No surprise.
In the last four years. A lot of other things that have to do with anger has just been on the rise as well. Mm. And so I thought this would make an interesting thing to reflect on a little bit.
I'm curious how many people were angry listening to your sermon.
Well, the thing is, it has to be generally enough because you can't say, okay, well, you guys are angry about X, Y, and Z.
Oh, absolutely not. Yeah.
Because we're all there at different times, right?
Right.
But the thing is, can we totally trust this emotion? Like, how many times have we gotten just livid about something, and then a week later, maybe the problem isn't even fixed yet, but we have calmed down enough to where we can actually start to go about the good work of fixing things. And so in the moment, we're actually the only part of God's creation in all of creation that has this ability to have a feeling and then step back and try to evaluate, is this good, like what it's trying to send me on, the path that my feeling is trying to say, go do this. Mm-hmm. Is this a healthy thing? And I think really the great wisdom is, no surprise, can be found in the psalm that, you know, the God is slow to anger. It exists. It's not even always bad. Sometimes it's good. But it's important that sometimes we're slow to anger and not do the snap thing, because that's where it sends us off the rails, oh, right?
Yeah. Quickly, if you allow it.
If you allow it to.
Yeah.
And so we kind of talked about each of these stories a little bit and evaluating as, like, you guys can decide, you know, was Jonah in the right for his indignant rage about the bush dying when he didn't? God is like, shouldn't you care more about this city over here? Which then he did not end up destroying, you know. And then, of course, in Matthew, the guy character, the vineyard owner, mm-hmm. is like, I'm just being generous with what I have, you know, just not necessarily to you.
Are you jealous?
Getting us to look, and it's that thing that we try to do so often, getting us to try to look outside of ourselves. Uh-huh. You know, Jonah, be happy for all the people in Nineveh that are not going to be destroyed. Right. You know, maybe the worker could be happy for everyone else, you know, who maybe needed the extra, you know.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they waited all day.
Yeah.
Gee.
So
that's a totally different direction. I love it.
Yeah. And but then there's also good news too. There always has to be good news when we try to do something, you know, the law, and then we fail, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the very end of the gospel, what does he call the indignant worker who is just so upset with him?
Friend,
yes, he calls you friend. And then we get a little piece of good news about our God as well, because what is the last label for the God character is, mm-hmm. Because I am generous, you know. That's what Jesus labels the vineyard owner. We have a generous God.
Receive this agape love I give to you. Yeah. That's great. And you actually even chose one of my favorite hymns, too.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
That's a classic.
See, there we go. So we have Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
Yeah, should be a few versions here.
Oh, I think I picked a good one.
Nice.
Strong. Jesus.
you go.
Yeah, so it just kind of makes you want to sing along, right?
Yeah, it's almost has that country slash gospel-y feel to it.
It does, yeah, yeah.
With the nice groove, the drum set, and then the piano and the ornamentation and stuff. I love it. So why this song?
Well, I thought that this was a good one because the thing that we're asking, as so often as we do ask in the sermons that people try, is a challenging thing, right? Mm-hmm. Because when we get mad, we're just mad. It's really hard in that moment to do the whole slow to anger bit, you know, and step back and evaluate things a little more, as would help us. But I thought, you know, we never do that by ourselves. If we remember that God is walking with us, yeah, a little bit closer than we might know, it was just kind of a good song to follow up the message that we have company as we're going about trying to do this good work.
Let it be. Well, that's great. Well, thank you so much, Pastor Joe Iverson from Zion Lutheran Church. I appreciate it, and I hope you can join us again.
Yeah, well, thanks for asking me. It was great to be here.
Ditto. Thank you.
And there you have it, everyone. Thank you for joining us, and please join us again next time for the good news and the notes with Pastor Phil. Thank you, and goodbye.